With each new generation of video game hardware, the graphical quality of new titles continues to mature. But a lot of older games are now being revisited through re-releases and remasters, or they're simply made available once again on modern hardware. While they can be rendered at higher frame rates and resolutions, they're fundamentally limited by the textures developed by artists for the game. So what if we can use AI to update the textures from older games so that they're larger, crisper, and more detailed for running at higher resolutions? I'm Tommy Thompson, welcome to AI in Games. In this episode, we're going to take a look at a process referred to as Super Resolution, where you feed an image into a trained deep learning algorithm and it generates a version of that image at a higher resolution while maintaining the artist's original intent. We'll take a look at how it works and the games that have benefited from it, ranging from AAA titles such as the recent Mass Effect Legendary Edition, but also the modding communities that have pioneered this idea over the last couple of years. So let's start by explaining a little bit of how graphics works in games and why super resolution for textures can prove valuable. In two-dimensional games, objects are put together courtesy of pixel art that is used to represent a given object, such as the player character, the background environment, and everything else in between. Moving characters will have a sprite atlas that allows you to swap out the active sprite at runtime to convey a change in behaviour. However, for three-dimensional games, objects are now comprised of multiple elements. The two key elements are the model and its textures. Any object in a 3D game, be it a character, prop, or environment, is effectively blank upon creation. This model is sculpted by a 3D artist and then it is textured to give it detail. But there's more than one texture applied to any given object. While there is the main detail, typically referred to as the diffuse texture, there are additional textures used to help render that object in different light conditions. That includes your normal map for adding vertex details, a specular map for controlling colour, and an emissive for non-cascading glows. This process has evolved in the past 10 years or so, given the adoption of the physical-based rendering or PBR tech in the likes of Unreal Engine, but while the workflow has slightly changed, the practice of applying multiple textures for surface and then detail to a model is the norm. Now, one of the big differences between 2D and 3D games is that 2D games largely hold up over time given the aesthetic of the sprite art. Plus, those games are designed to be rendered at a fixed resolution. You can't really change the resolution without skewering the art. So when they're brought over to modern platforms, there is typically some form of scaling going on that helps retain the original aspect ratio, even if it begins to look a little chunky on modern screens, and there are options for smoothing that out. However, this pixelated chunkiness, yes, that's the scientific term for it, is exacerbated when you try to run older 3D games at higher resolutions. Rendering a 3D game at a higher resolution will result in the models looking sharper and ultimately presenting a more crisp image, but the textures used on those objects begin to look really bad. They look really stretched out and heavily pixelated. Why? Because those textures were designed to support the game at the target resolution for when it was released. Nobody working on Doom back in 1993 figured that people would be playing that game 30 years later on a 32-inch 4K widescreen gaming monitor. It was built to support the graphics and memory capabilities of the hardware at that time, and the monitors it would have rendered on. Even games from the last 20 years dating back to the Nintendo GameCube, PlayStation 2, and the original Xbox suffer from the same fate given the limitations of the hardware. More modern games have been able to work around this, given artists will typically build the original textures at a higher resolution than the target hardware. Hence, a game receives a high-resolution texture pack as a DLC update on PlayStation 5 and Xbox Series X, because while it shipped with 1080p textures on the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One, those were already downsampled from the original 4K textures made during development. Downsampling textures is a common practice, especially for multi-platform games targeting different resolutions and memory budgets. You are making a smaller texture that is less sharp an image, but it retains all of the core detail of the original while minimizing pixelation or artifacts. While this is a relatively straightforward process in modern game engines, you can't go the other way around. You can't make an original texture bigger without it looking chunky or blocky. And that's where the AI comes in. AI upscaling attempts to reproduce the original image at a higher resolution while minimizing the pixelation and artifacts. This is achieved using a machine learning model that understands the underlying details of that image and can refine it as it is made bigger. Now, it can't add information that isn't already there. So, for example, blurred illegible text written on signs can't now be made legible given it doesn't know what it said to begin with, but it can remove a lot of noise and grain from an image such that it is sharper and less pixelated. This can be applied either to sprites and art for classic 2D games or all of the different texture layers used in 3D, and we're going to be focusing on 3D games for the remainder of this video. In conjunction with all of this, there is ongoing work in texture synthesis, where AI is being used to figure out how an existing texture would have been drawn if it had a bigger canvas to work with. But that's a topic for another time. Texture upscaling is slowly becoming an industry in and of itself, with many companies such as Topaz Labs now selling their own software for super resolution, denoising and sharpening images and even videos, given they are, after all, a series of static images creating the illusion of movement. Meanwhile, Nvidia has their own NGX development tools, used for upscaling and more, that are all designed to run on an RTX-capable GPU, and Adobe has recently integrated a super resolution feature into their Camera Raw program. Plus, as we'll see in a moment, many of the tools to start building your own super resolution AI are freely available online, and as such, many modders have started applying it to their favourite games. Now, all of this sounds pretty exciting, but it also sounds very similar to what is known as DLSS, or Deep Learning Supersampling. DLSS is an upscaling technology developed by Nvidia that runs on their RTX graphics cards. While similar, there are some differences in how it executes, and it's worth clarifying what those are. Deep Learning Supersampling essentially achieves both upscaling of the image as well as attempting some anti-aliasing, but it's upscaling from the output of the system's graphical processing unit, or GPU. DLSS is designed with the intent of allowing the graphics card to render the game while you're playing it at a lower resolution than normal, meaning it uses less resource, and then the AI part upscales the image before it makes it to your screen. So you might have your GPU render the game at 1080p, and then the DLSS upscales that image to 4K to appear on your monitor. This is because the DLSS had a model trained for that game that knows how it should look at a higher resolution. However, texture upscaling is all done in advance. You up-res the textures in the game during development, and then you use it to replace the existing texture assets stored in the game engine. Naturally, this now means an increase in required GPU power and memory, given you're now rendering higher resolution images, but none of the upscaling process is happening at runtime. It was all completed long before the player ever got their hands on the game. If you are interested in finding out more about DLSS, the next episode of AI in Games complements this one as we go into detail on DLSS and how that works as well, so be sure to check that out. Okay, so let's get into the weeds. How does the texture upscaling actually work? It's reliant on deep learning, a process that uses deep convolutional neural networks that are trained to upscale the image. But in particular, it's reliant on a technique called generative adversarial networks. And this means there's not just one, but two networks at play. One network is attempting to upscale the image to a higher quality, while the second acts as a critic, assessing how good the images are and determines whether they are fake or not. If they are deemed fake, then they are discarded. This process of generator and discriminator is critical to the process. Both networks need to learn about the images they're dealing with. The discriminator needs to be able to identify images that evoke specific properties, while the generator needs to create new images that retain those artistic values sufficiently such that they can fool the discriminator. This isn't the first time we've talked about generative adversarial networks on this channel, given if we pop back to episode 39, we highlighted early research in using GANs to train Mario levels by reading in the level graphics. Now, many of the examples we see throughout this video are driven by a particular type of generative adversarial network, an ESR GAN, or Enhanced Super Resolution Generative Adversarial Network. Try saying that three times. Okay, so let's walk through how it works. The ESR GAN generator is powered by a convolutional neural network using convolution layers to capture information about the original low-resolution image. As that image is passed in, it's capturing what is known as the feature space. This is a collection of properties used to describe specific patterns or concepts in the image, whether it's fur or brick or any other common property or trait in that image. The convolutional layers are being used to process all of that information and store it such that when the super resolution image is made, that new image will still retain that same feature space. So with this information captured, the generator begins to upscale the image to create the super resolution equivalent. Now typically, a GANs discriminator is interested in detecting fake output, that an image from the generator is not real and an attempted forgery of the training set. Instead, the ESR GAN uses what is referred to as a relativistic discriminator, meaning it assesses whether an image could be considered more realistic than the other one, rather than whether the image is fake. This is a small but critical distinction, given it's more interested in assessing the difference between the real input and fake output. This actually helps the ESR GAN learn more effectively, given it can better differentiate the key distinctions between the original image and the fake one, and focus on reproducing those in the final image. The modified discriminator combined with changes to the generator GAN structure lead to one of the big benefits of ESR GAN compared to other super resolution GANs. It does a better job of retaining sharpness and detail in textures. A lot of existing methods would suffer from significant blurring of things like fur, whiskers, and hair, or would lose detail in elements such as brickwork or tiling. These changes made a huge improvement to the overall performance. Now, while this technique works really well, it's still not perfect. A lot of super resolution really benefits from higher quality images to begin with. So, for example, upscaling from 1080p to 4K is a lot easier than grabbing much lower resolution images to start with. These will often result in artifacts that impact the final high resolution image, an issue that impacts many of the projects we discuss later in this video. All of this, of course, is just a high-level summary, and a list of resources on the intricacies of ESR GANs are available in the video description for our more scholarly viewers. Now, let's start looking at the impact this is all beginning to have on the video games industry. The boom in super resolution has only really kicked off in the last 3 years, given the ESR GAN that we just explored was only first published back in 2018. But it's already having a huge impact in games, and much of this stems from modding communities. Many modding communities have long-established practices of providing revised texture packs for beloved games, and in many instances, there are groups of people working on new textures to replace existing ones, such as the New Vision 1.5 mod for Deus Ex. But now there is a new wave of super resolution mods being released where creators have ripped the original textures out of the game and passed them through the deep learning process to great effect. There are many notable examples out there, such as Deus Ex New Vision 2.0, and we're going to take a look at some of them in a little more detail. First up, there is Doom Neural Upscale 2X, which you can download and run with any GZ Doom installation. This made a splash in early 2018 and is reliant on Nvidia's GameWorks tools, which are a predecessor to their current Nvidia NGX. Plus, they use the Topaz Labs upscaler I mentioned earlier. What makes this set of Doom textures really interesting is that, as you can see from watching the footage, the resolution has not been scaled up as high as you might expect. In fact, as the name implies, the textures here are only 2 times their original size, and a big reason for that was to retain their artistic integrity and clarity. During development, they were originally upscaled all the way up to 8 times their original size, but as a result of the super resolution process, some artifacts started to appear in the final textures and sprites. A big reason for that is that the original images are really small. As mentioned earlier, super resolution is relying on whatever information is already in the image and capturing that feature space. Hence, you might be able to up-res a 1080p image to 4K quite nicely, because the base image has a lot of detail to work with. However, the majority of the original Doom textures are only 64x128, and in some cases are 128x128. Hence, trying to upscale them to 8 times their original size is going to result in problems, as there isn't a lot of information to go on. So after upscaling to 8 times their original size, they were then downscaled to 2 times their size, and then cleaned up by hand to remove any artifacts. Plus, any transparency masks applied needed to be resolved manually as well. Still, it looks pretty great, and it gives me an excuse to go and play Doom again for the 800th time. Max Payne Remastered was first released in late 2018 and received a couple of updates into early 2019. It's a notable example of ESR GANs, and much like Doom, it's a process of both automatically creating the desired textures as well as a bit of manual tweaking. The remastered mod replaced around a couple of thousand of the original textures, which accounts for around 95% of the original art assets from the game. The textures in this mod range from a small 2x upscale all the way to 8x in some instances. This, combined with a boost in resolution, is rather effective, and the game really does look a lot crisper and more accessible on modern devices, removing much of the blur that arises from the stretching of those relatively small textures to larger resolutions. Lastly, I wanted to take a moment to highlight that this isn't just for PC games. A suite of texture packs for consoles have also been appearing for use in emulators, such as this set for Metroid Prime on the Nintendo GameCube. There is a slow and growing community of modders providing texture sets for the Dolphin emulator, allowing you to upscale many a classic GameCube title, including the likes of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater and Super Mario Sunshine. And so now, with the likes of the Mass Effect Legendary Edition, we're beginning to see these techniques being applied by studios as part of their art production. AI upscaling was only one part of a much larger effort at rebuilding the art assets of the Mass Effect trilogy, with the likes of material shaders and particle systems being updated alongside the base character models and textures themselves. Meanwhile, some materials were simply too low resolution to benefit from the upscaling, so they had to go in and do it themselves. The Mass Effect trilogy was originally built in Unreal Engine 3, which was more than capable of handling the graphical expectations of contemporary hardware. But since the first game released back in 2007, the rendering capabilities have increased drastically. A lot of the Mass Effect games actually ran at 720p resolution on the likes of the PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360, so the textures and character models were often downscaled from their original versions. For the remaster, BioWare moved towards a later version of UE3 that could handle the original model and texture sizes, and then went ahead and upscaled the original files. The move towards using AI upscaling was really one of minimizing time and resources spent on the project, given the team sought to remaster as many textures from the original trilogy as possible. This was a significant undertaking, with over 30,000 textures being upscaled to around 4x their original size. While this is achieved through an automated batch process, it requires a lot of human oversight, especially given it's important that consistency between the likes of the diffuse, albedo, and normal maps are retained. Otherwise, a lot of detail would begin to look broken or mangled. Even with this batch automation, the art team still went in and manually cleaned up all of the upscaled textures. In addition, many of the character models used in the remaster are based on the higher quality versions created in the latter games, and they were used as the starting point for the remasters. But still, this required the art team to go in, manually check all the textures are up to scratch, and clean them up. Plus, many of the character textures received even more love as the art team sought to improve on the existing versions. Ultimately, the AI upscaling was just part of a significant body of work to revamp all of the art assets from the game. It still requires a large amount of time and energy from the art team to spot issues arising from the upscaling, clean them up, and even go in and add that detail that the deep neural network simply cannot generate. Plus, the upscaling was also applied in another area. Some of the cutscenes also got up-res too. While the vast majority of the cinematics were re-rendered in-engine in 4K resolution, for some of them, this wasn't possible, so they went and upscaled the original video files. This is very similar to that scene back in episode 53, where the same process was applied to the cutscenes in Command & Conquer Remastered. While the rest of the game received a handcrafted 4K upgrade, the cutscenes utilized AI upscaling because the original video files have been lost to time. Texture upscaling through super resolution is an exciting new avenue for helping games to look fresh and adapt to modern hardware. While you cannot entirely revamp the image with new details or intricacies, it acts as a great starting point that you can then drop into an existing game or use as a base point for human artists to take over. The state of the art in super resolution is still an ongoing development, and we can be sure to see more work like this emerging in modding communities and remasters of classic games in the coming years. Thanks for watching this episode of AI in Games. If you're keen to find out more about super resolution and a lot of the exciting work out there, be sure to subscribe to Karoly Jornaferrer and his work over on 2-Minute Papers, which has highlighted several big innovations in recent years. Plus, check out the R Game Upscale subreddit. I wouldn't usually recommend reading Reddit, but the community there shares a lot of advice and shows progress on their modding projects. This episode of AI in Games was voted for by our wonderful crowdfunding community. To see more videos like this one and have your say on what is covered next, Support the show via the links on screen and in the description over on Patreon. Take care, folks, and I'll be back.